Good morning.
Good morning.
It is good to see everybody again this morning. Did y'all have a piece of Christmas?
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen. Okay. Well, that's good to know. Announcements for this morning. Of course, worship small groups tonight at 6. Wednesday, movie War Room. And basically, that's all our announcements for today. Loving Him this morning is revive us again. After Christmas and get worn out, we might need to go revive and get us back into the swing, get our energy back. We praise Thee, O God, for the Son of my love, for Jesus who died and is gone above. Hallelujah, my glory, hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, my glory, revive us again. Let's stand, please. All glory and praise to the Lamb that was slain, who has borne all our sins and has cleansed every stain. Hallelujah, my glory, hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, my glory. Okay, a little bit of meet and greet. Short meet and greet.
Thank you.
learn to walk in your way. Step by step, you'll lead me. I love my day. Lord, you are my God. And I will never praise you. God, you are my God. And I will never praise you. I will see the day in the morning, and I will learn to walk in your way. And step by step, you'll lead me. And I will walk in all of my days. I will walk in all of my days. I will walk in all of my days. Step by step, you lead me. I am my
Amen. Amen. Turn a little more activity back there. Yeah, I can see you guys have a blast in the back. Okay,
Richard.
Yes.
We have something that does happen to us. On Sundays. We have a rose between two thorns.
Thinking it's gold.
John, don't you feel much by me there? Okay. Now, our prayer list, as always, keep me in prayer for those who need to make a decision, and also those who have fallen away. Judge Trailey and Miranda Dennison, their families. Goldie, she seeks answers from the medical field. Doesn't that field get pretty big sometimes, Goldie?
Amen, it does.
Tell you what. Sharon Adams hospitalized this past week at Trinity West. Don't often do this, but so that you get the whole gist of what's going on. Dean received this from Joe Santa. Okay, so he won't be in church. Two trips to the emergency room with Owen yesterday. The high fever, ear infection. They gave him Augmentin. Within 10 minutes, he had hives. They gave him Benadryl. It cleared up, discharged. He went home. 30 minutes later, hives returned even worse. And back to the ER at 1 a.m. He and Jess Santa were taken by squad to Children's in Pittsburgh June following. Many doctors tested later, it was confirmed that it was a really extreme allergic reaction to Augmentin. And after close observation, he was discharged at 6 a.m. yesterday?
Yes.
Okay. Hives come and go, fever up and down. Concerned right now because his respirations are fast. He's a sick little guy. Miranda not doing well either. And Jim's sister,
Margaret Staff.
Margaret Staff, also is not well at all. And I fear she only has a few days to live. So would you keep them in your family?
I just got a text from Miss Anna. Owen's fever up and down, face now is a little swollen. Did not eat normally, very fussy, tossing as to whether we should go back to the Children's Hospital. Breathing is still good. And so she said, thank you, friend, for checking. Please thank the church family for the prayers in advance. Flood God, asking God to be well, or asking Owen. In other words, flood God with prayers to ask for Owen to be well.
Also, Grace Brownie. Grace is traveling this weekend, so we ask you to keep all those folks in prayer. Prayer this morning is Sweet Hour of Prayer, and
yeah, right here.
Yeah, Brother Dave will have our morning prayer. Sweet hour of prayer that calls me from the world of care and makes me at my Father's throne.
Make all my wants and wishes known. In seas and troubles, stress and grief, my soul has loved and found relief. And on this sea, let tempter snare my God returns. Sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, we shall find the petition there. To him the truth and faithfulness, he leads the way so to bless. And since he prays, we see his face, believe his word and trust his grace. As on him my every guess will be, for the sweet hour of prayer.
Heavenly Father, we'd like to come to you now. We know that you are our Father in heaven. You are the creator of everything. You have many names. We have our Father. You have our God, and you also have Yahweh. And Heavenly Father, I thank you for this. Heavenly Father, I come to you now for the congregation of the Hopedale Church of Christ and all their prayers. And I come to you through the gift of the Holy Spirit. Heavenly Father, we have many names upon our hearts. And as it teaches us in the Bible, the lady who just touched your heart was healed. And that's all she had to do because she believed in you. And Heavenly Father, we can't touch your garment. We can come to you with prayer. We know that prayers be answered. And Heavenly Father, would you be with Josephine and Owen and Owen's mother? Two out of three have cancer. And it's our prayer they're reaching out to you. And just let them touch your heart. From all the prayers of everybody here in the congregation. And Heavenly Father, there are more upon our prayers. I haven't forgotten. I just came in and brought them. And the Hopedale Church of Christ that you receive. And Heavenly Father, you are the creator of everything. And we know that the Church is just your blessing. And Heavenly Father, thank you. Guiding us and watching over us as you do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The meeting here this morning is O come, again. And there we're still in this part of the season, we're still remembering the birth of Christ. So just something to share with you here. Wonderful Counselor, Prince of Peace, just a few of the descriptions used in Isaiah to describe the child to come. This baby born in a stable and laid in a manger. What a humble beginning for the child whose birth we celebrate this time of year. That this child was the greatest gift to mankind, the Savior of the world, Jesus. set by God to redeem us from our sins. When he grew up, he spread the gift of salvation to the lost and dying world. The counselor of all the world was the greatest, with the greatest story ever told, salvation. He fulfilled the plan of his Father. He died a cruel death on the cross to save us from our sins. Just now, as we gather to praise his birth, we also honor his death, burial, and resurrection by sharing at the table his body and his blood. As he commanded, to remember the sacrifice for us. So, as we share, let's honor the child and praise the Savior. So come, O come, Emmanuel.
Heavenly Father, we'd like to come to you now at this part of our service. We'd like to give you all the praise, all the glory that is due to you, because you are worth everything. And Heavenly Father, we'd like to thank you for your Son, for when he went to Calvary, because the bread of his promise table is what happened before he went there. He took the disciples and he said, "Here, take this bread, this is my body." And Heavenly Father loves everyone, everyone. The Son loving bread is a symbol of Jesus' body. But Heavenly Father, the ones that done this before us and the ones that are going to do it after us, let each and every one of us understand that your Son did die for each and every one of us. Because you know there are lots of veterans that never come back from the wars. And Arlington Cemetery, they're full of white crosses. I believe that they understood. Just a little bit of what your son went through. Because they died to give us the right to live in this country the way we do. And your son died for each and every one of us that accept him to be our Lord and Savior. And I know that he sits at your right hand now. So Heavenly Father, bless the bread that is upon this table. Bless the men that are here to serve. Thank you.
Dear Lord, we just sang a song that said, rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel is coming to Israel. I wonder if we can honestly say that. You know, I believe that we need a revival, and I think it starts with me. We need to get back to the roots of things. And I think this is, that's why we gather around the table some, because it's the root of our foundation of our faith. Oh dear Lord, I am so grateful that you came. He was born, but the most thing I'm grateful for is that you got died on the cross. Wow. You did that just for us. Thank you so very much. You shed that blood on the cross. And that's what the juice represents, is the blood. As David has mentioned, our veterans and how they have died. Wow. Touches home, does it not? I believe we need to start getting energized for you. Start to see exactly how we should do Bible things and Bible ways. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for the time that we have to spend in your house to praise your awesome grace. Let your words touch each and every one of our hearts the way it always does. And most of all, thank you so much for your Son, Jesus Christ, who gave that ultimate sacrifice and died on that cross for our sins, and rose up to show us the direction we need to go by following your words and your scripture. As we come to this time for service to give back to you, let us give back with a very open heart and continue building on your kingdom. Bless those that can give, and bless those to sue so fortunate that can't give. For this is in Jesus Christ's name.
Hear what I hear. bring me through the skies and the cold. Do you hear what I feel? A song, high above the trees with the voices big as the sea. With a voice as big as the sea. Said the shepherd boy to the mighty king, do you know what I know? In your palace, oh mighty king, do you know what I know? A child shivers in the cold and the spring is silver and gold. Let us bring him silver and gold.
Children's Church after this song, give thanks with a grateful heart. Children's Church today, is that right? I want your kids to go to Children's Church and be found out there next door to this one.
Give thanks. Give thanks.
Give thanks.
felt like I was at a wedding there for a moment, but I wanted to get down and be seated. And we do have an additional prayer request. It was Ray Peterson, I believe it is, that right down in the Texas area, Dallas, they tried to call him, and he said, you know, there's a lot of storms, and the neighbors down that way, and the associate, Greg Peterson, all those down that way in prayer as well. So we've had some other word from some of our brothers and sisters in Christ, but he's been wondering where Randy and Karen Ryan has been. I was wondering myself. They're back in New York, and they're not going to be back for spring, so there's a letter here from them, and I'll post that on the bulletin board in the back. So if you're wondering, where's Randy and Karen? Okay. There's also a Christmas card here from Brother Glenn Christie in Illinois with his daughter Carla, and a thank you note from Don and Diana Richards for the goodie basket. They really appreciate that goodie basket that came around. This Wednesday, we have a special Wednesday service at 6 p.m. And Bessie, I took one of these from the house.
Without permission.
Took one of these copies of War Room. Have you heard of War Room? From the directors of Fireproof and Courageous. It's a movie. And it was the number one hit just a few months ago when it was released in theaters. Just came out just before Christmas time. Some of you may have received it for Christmas. We're going to show this film about the power and the necessity of prayer in lives. So, if you want more information on that, you can see this little thing right here, or you can Google it. It's a powerful film. I thought it would be a good way to spend our Wednesday evening together. And we wish you all Happy New Year. And I realize some of you I won't see until next year. Good news, though, by the way, as of December 25th, just a couple days ago, as of December 25th, there were 366 days until Christmas. This is a leap year. So you get an extra day. So you get all that Christmas shopping done. I suggest you do it on February 29th. Okay? February 29th. Well, do that Christmas shopping. Are you glad to be here today?
Yeah.
I am too. I'm just glad to be with you because I realize that I'm addressing royalty this morning. And I am excited to be with you. So let's get right down to it, shall we? You probably know what we've been covering the last few weeks, but maybe you don't. And so let's kind of recap what we're doing. And this will be the final sermon in a series of sermons on all, remember what the theme is? All things possible. All things are possible with God. I just want to kind of carry you through in a couple moments here of where we've been and where we want to go on this final message today. The very first message we preached a few weeks ago dealt with the conception of Jesus Christ in the womb of Mary, where the Holy Spirit would overshadow her and she would be with child. So Jesus had no earthly father, according to the Word of God, but through the Holy Spirit, Jesus would be conceived. And we marvel at that. That's amazing. And even Mary was marveling at it. She said, how can this be? How can this be? I've not even been with a man. And the angel said to her, with God, nothing shall be impossible. So we talked about the conception of Jesus Christ, and even went back to the very creation of the world in Genesis 1:1, where the Bible says what? In the beginning, God what? Created. And he made everything that we now see simply by speaking it into existence. That's powerful. Then the following week, this next slide over, just remind you, just bring back an old mind of where we're going. All trying to fit it together, this thing, all things possible. And that was the idea of perfection. And once we looked at the life of Jesus as he grew and he lived a perfect life, the Bible says he was tempted in all points, yet what? Without any sin. I doubt that we've been tempted in all points because Satan doesn't have to work that hard on us. But with Jesus, Satan tried every which way he could to get Jesus to sin. He never sinned once. And as a result of that, it showed to us the life of Jesus that we covered the following week with this topic of consecration. Can you say that word with me again as I asked you a couple weeks ago? Ready? Consecration. Now, it's a word we don't use very often in our society today, but it has to do with a conscious, deliberate application and focus on God's holiness and a desire to please God and do what he wants us to do, to let him be the Lord of our life. How many of you realize that's a struggle? At times. Someone said, what do you mean at times? It's a struggle all the time. This is probably one of the easiest times right here in this assembly to allow Jesus Christ to be Lord because there are no distractions and we're focused on his holiness and his glory. But as soon as we walk out those doors, it's going to hit us in. When we're doing the meet and greet, it was a lot of fun back here in meet and greet, especially in the back when I ran to Donnie Logan and I said, kind of like a Walmart.
You know, it's kind of like, and it was, you know, and it was kind of like we started, but at Walmart, it's not so friendly, is it? And I kind of handed him that film for a moment. So I'm fighting with this film. And I think you were talking about, never mind.
We won't go there, Tony.
Okay. But it was a lot of fun. How many of you understand that right here it's easy to be a Christian? And that it's easy to be consecrated here, at least outwardly. But I don't know what's going on in your inside right now. Okay, so whatever's going on in your inside of your life, when you walk out that door, it's going to hit you, the world's going to hit you, the temptations are going to come. And to carry on through that week, that consecrated life. And so the fourth topic we covered Christmas Eve, just touched on it briefly, and it's the idea of redemption. Redemption. Now, redemption is simply this. It's when you've lost something that's precious to you, and I guess it doesn't even have to be precious to you, but maybe then you realize how precious it should have been. You lose it, it becomes someone else's possession, and you'd like to have it back. So it doesn't have to be you. And so you go through the process of getting that possession back. And once you've accomplished that, that's called redemption. It's like that possession has been redeemed. But redemption is far more precious with you and me because we're not talking about things, are we? We're talking about what? We're talking about people. We're talking about persons. We're talking about you. When Adam and Eve in the garden lost their closeness with God, that fellowship with God, God wanted to have that partnership back. He wanted to have it restored. And so the plan was through the conception of the Holy Spirit in the womb of Mary to send Jesus to live a perfect life and die for our sins on the cross to be the atonement, the payment for our sin. And as a result of that, in our response to Jesus, if we accept the gift that he gave on the cross, we're redeemed. And Jesus said, no matter how bad it gets, lift up your heads because your redemption draw near. And our redemption is Jesus Christ. A thought struck me the other day, even before I realized that today was going to be Sunday. So what do you mean? Well, I don't know about you, but I went to bed Friday night, and I realized the next day was Saturday. And I go, that, and I'm like, tomorrow's Saturday. That means the following day is Sunday. And so all of a sudden, I'm like, I need to be over here, and I need to get things ready for our Sunday service. And so Saturday morning, I was up early, and I was going over this final form. And I just like to call it navigation. We were talking about that this morning, weren't we? How many of you use GPS? GPS navigation. I like what Ron said this morning. He said something about the reason they put it in a woman's voice, not a man's voice. Because if it was a man's voice, it would say something like, I know a shortcut. I know a better way. I really like that because the navigation, in regard to navigating safely to heaven, hear this, there are no shortcuts. It's God's way. You got to do it God's way. And God knows how to get us there safely in navigation. I was originally going to share a portion of this book with you. I'm just going to kind of highlight it in my mind. If I shared it word for word, it'd take about 6 minutes. Okay? Don't time me on this. But the name of the book is 21 Laws of Leadership. I highly recommend it for your library. It's written by John Maxwell. And in one of the chapters, and it's chapter number 4, it's called The Law of Navigation. He opens up the story. He opens up that chapter about the quest and the attempt to get to the South Pole. I don't know about you, but I'm just not interested in going there. I've enjoyed actually the summer weather. The summer weather this Christmas, how about you? I mean, I've just been thrilled to know what it's like to have Christmas and not really have to go to Florida. Now I know what it's like in Florida without actually going there. Okay, I've enjoyed the warm weather and all, but these two individuals, a fellow by the name of Amundsen and another fellow by the name of Scott, they were both on a race to get to the South Pole. Amundsen planned everything carefully. He chose the best men. He had the best equipment. He planned everything on his route meticulously. He thought well ahead and prepared for the journey to get to the South Pole and return home safely. Even his supply depots were strategically placed and well marked all along the way. They chose to have dog sleds to carry the supplies. After a careful study, he figured that was the best way to do it. And they would cover, I don't know how many miles a day, but they would only travel 6 hours out of the day. And the rest of the time, they would rest. They give the dogs time to rest, And the biggest problem that they had on the whole trip was one man had an infected tooth and had to have it extracted. That was the biggest problem they had. Scott, on the other hand, who was a military officer, by the way, by military officer, probably had nothing to do with what I'm about to tell you, but he did not plan carefully. He did not have his supplies carefully marked. He decided to use motorized sledges and horses to travel. And as soon as they got to the base of the Antarctic Mountains, 5 days in, the horses began dying because of the extreme cold. They had to put the animals down. The sledges, the motorized sledges, quit working. And so the men had to pull the supply. Not only that, they had enough supplies for four men, and at the very last minute, he decided it would be a good idea to add a fifth man. Their clothing was not adequate. The goggles weren't the best, and many of them suffered from what they call that, snow blindness. They covered 800 miles in 10 weeks. It was arduous. It was painful. One man, it took him an hour every morning just to get his gangrene feet into his boots. By the time they reached the South Pole, there was the other flag from Amundsen already planted from 1 month earlier. Now it was time to head back home. To make matters even worse, Scott thought it would be a good idea to get 30 pounds of geological rocks to bring back for later study. And his men continued to carry it. One of his members in the expedition did not want it to be a burden to the rest of the men. Said, "I'm going out for a while. I'll be a while." He purposely went out to die, so he wouldn't be a burden to the rest of the team. Finally, two of them were left about 150 miles from the base camp. We know what happened because years later, or however long later, they found their diaries that talk about the whole trip. I simply told you the tales of two individuals that were attempting to reach the South Pole. One individual carefully planned, thought it out in advance, so he could navigate safely to the South Pole and back. The other wanted to accomplish the same thing, but because of his failure to carefully plan and navigate in a safe way, he died. How many of you know that in our spiritual walk, it truly is a matter of life and death? Now, I don't know about you, and I really don't care about you on this particular topic, but I don't want to go to the South Pole. If you want to go ahead. You want to go to the South Pole, right? You want to go to the North Pole, go ahead. But at this point, I do care about you. I want to go to heaven. How about you? I really do care about you. If you go to the South Pole, I'm not going to miss that experience one day. But when it comes to getting to heaven, I want you to be there. And you must want you to be there as well. And so I offer this to help navigate us safely to heaven's shore. Anyone interested in this morning? Navigating safely to heaven's shore. In John chapter 16, verse 13, I will use this as the basis for everything I'm trying to relate today to you. A lot of times, people will come and ask me questions about the Bible. Let's say something like this. What does the Bible say about, and then you fill in the blank? And so, I will try to give an answer on what the Bible says. I have a question for you. Do you think they listen to me all the time? They don't, and it puzzled me. It puzzled me. Why bother asking me if you're not going to listen to what I have to say from the Word of God? Now, my purpose for giving you an answer is not that I mind you asking. I don't mind at all. I appreciate the questions. I think it's a good idea to ask questions. Thomas asked questions. Lord, we don't know where to go. How do we know the way? Jesus says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. And so Thomas had to accept that and follow what Jesus had to say. There was a man from Ethiopia in the book of Acts that was asking some questions. I don't know, understand what I'm reading here. What's this mean? And so Philip, in Acts chapter 8, explained to the Ethiopian. And thankfully, the Ethiopian responded to listen. The church at Corinth asked the Apostle Paul some questions. And so when Paul writes 1 Corinthians, he said, I'm going to answer some of the questions that you had. Because if just me or you as well, though, when people ask you a question, you give them the answer and they don't take the answer, they don't accept it. Does that bug you? You feel like it's been a waste of time? I've had people ask me, for instance, Brother Dana, do you think we'll recognize each other in heaven? And I give them all the Bible references I can think of that point out, yes, we will recognize each other in heaven. They go away and say, I don't think we will. Brother Dean, and I have one couple from this town, very good friends of Beth and Mom. We run into them periodically when we go out to eat and so forth. They're good friends. They asked me, Brother Dean asked me about baptism. Is baptism, should we be immersed? I mean, you know, that's a loaded question to ask the Church of Christ. I mean, should we? Oh, how so? Yes. Whoa, but I don't do that easy. I won't do that to you. I don't know where Bessie was that day when the cat and sheep gone to the bank and ran into McDonald's and then they asked a question. And then Bessie's like, you know, we were going somewhere and I said, I'll be out in 2 minutes. And what was it, 20 minutes later? Here comes Dean. I still pray the Lord will open our heart to respond, but I want you to know I was disappointed when he asked me, and so I gave them the Bible answer, baptism means to work, yet they have not yet accept that. Please don't get me wrong. Let's say it again. I'm not against people asking questions, but I do believe there's a better way. And it's in John chapter 16, verse 13. Because if you're a Christian this morning, this verse ought to give you hope that you have within you a counselor better than a preacher, a counselor better than anyone else that can give you the answers that you seek from God's Word. Jesus here is speaking, and he says, but when he identifies me, he is who? The Spirit of Truth. When he, the Spirit of Truth, comes, he will what? Guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own initiative. Whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will disclose to you what's to come. Now, if you'll turn to one more verse in Acts chapter 2, verse 38. In Acts chapter 2, verse 38, we find out that something happened for us when we responded to Jesus Christ, when we accepted Christ, when we repented of our sins, and when we were baptized. Now remember what he said. Remember what Jesus said. When the Spirit of Truth comes, he will guide you into all truth. Let's say that together. When the Spirit of Truth comes, he will guide you into all truth. Acts 2, verse 38. The crowd had asked, what should we do? When they heard the message, and Peter said, repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And what? You will receive what? Gift, the Holy Spirit. So when you were baptized, God gave you what Jesus promised. Actually, let me rephrase it. God gave you who Jesus promised. He gave you the gift of his Holy Spirit. And his Holy Spirit is the counselor of whom he spoke in John 16, 13. So when you're baptized into Christ, I'm trying to put this into words. It's like the Holy Spirit, who is the counselor, who has the source of all truth, he has come to live within you. And so now, when you open the Word of God to search for these answers, will we recognize each other in heaven? What about baptism? What about this? What about that? Blah, 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 blah. What about all these things? We then understand also that the Holy Spirit is what wrote the Word of God and put through the minds of those who wrote it and led them to write what they wrote. And so now we have the Holy Spirit within us. Middle of the night, 3 a.m. You don't have to call me anymore at 3 a.m. and ask me, will we recognize each other in heaven? No one's ever done that, but if you do, I promise not to come over and say, let me work it out for you so you know. You have the Spirit within you. Do you understand what I'm trying to say here? You can ask me. I'm not against asking the questions being asked. But a little initiative on our part as Christians, 2 Timothy 2:15, if you'll do some study on your part and not just rely on me. And that might apply to some of you. I don't know. I know it doesn't to some, but if you look at that Bible reading program that they've had for the last few years, you can tell they've been studying and reading, right? And even when they asked Jesus, Remember, they asked Jesus those questions. We used to joke about this, Goldie. We'd say, someone would say, what's the Bible say about this? And we'd say, that's a good question. Why don't you go research it and let me know what you find? That's exactly what Jesus said to his followers. We're talking about navigation here, folks. And if you're going to Columbus, and you're going to 3rd Street, 421 3rd Street, Columbus, how many of you need a GPS to do that off the top of your head? Now, I can make it to the Ohio State University Hospital without a GPS, but not the first time. But I've been there enough times, I can go right there. I'm going to tell you from there how to get there. And there'll be times that after you've studied God's Word enough, you won't even have to be opening your book to remember what it says. It's going to come to you like that because you put some personal initiative and you studied for yourself because you were relying on God's Holy Spirit to lead you in truth. You're like, God gave me His Spirit when I was baptized. And so He'll help me understand the truth. And so you open that book and you read it in 2 Timothy 2:15. What's it say? Give all diligence to present yourself approved unto God. Right? In the King James Version, that said study. Study to show yourself approved unto God. A workman that what? Needs not be ashamed, but one who accurately handles the word of truth. I pulled out a machete right now. I don't have one, by the way. But I saw one the other day. And I'm like, the first thing I thought was, I think dangerous. You know why? It's sharp! It had jagged stuff on one side, and it had a blade on the other. That thing's so sharp, just looking at it almost cut me. The Bible says that the Word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword. And so when you open that book, better handle it carefully and accurately. You understand what I'm saying? You understand what I'm saying, folks? We do it with cars. We do it with cars. We don't just hand the kid the keys over to the teenager and say, here, go. Don't worry about that license thing. Don't worry about driver's ed. Just here, here you go. You'll be fine. Right? I had a heart attack when I was teaching my daughter how to drive a stick shift. I made a mistake of handing the car over to her in the post office. That was the last place she wanted. I was a nervous wreck when we got out of the post office. I said, stop the car. It's good. Why? And I got out and flew over. Yeah, I wanted to teach her some things. So here you go. I want to talk about the approach. I want to talk about opening it. I want to talk about hearing it. I want to talk about responding to it. I want to give you these four points so we can navigate safely and make it to heaven. Amen? Make it to heaven. When you approach the Word of God, approach it for what it is, the Word of God. It's holy. It's a message that is spoken to generation after generation after generation for thousands of years. This book demands our utmost respect and reverence. I'm not necessarily talking about the physical copy of the Bible, but yet, I believe we ought to treat it with reverence nonetheless. Let me illustrate. One of our colleagues, but I was in college, this was a few years ago, back when we had speech class. Don't tell them that I told you this, but in speech class, we delivered 5-minute sermons. Don't you dare tell anybody that there was a time when I could do it. And he was trying to impress upon us, why even bother having a Bible if you're not going to follow it? And he took his Bible and literally he threw it across the room. I have you know, I was offended. You don't have to do that to get your point across. But he thought he did. When you approach this book, you approach it for what it is. It is the Word of God. Now, if our house were burned down, or your house were burned, and you get out, and all your Bibles are there, listen, we have Jesus' promise. He said, heaven and earth will pass away, but what about this book? My word will never pass away. So I'm not interested in worshiping the physical copy of it, though I do believe we have to treat it respectful. When we approach it, we realize that when we approach it, what's the next thing we're going to do? We're going to open it. That's the second thing we're going to do. And so when we open it for what it is, the Word of God. Don't study it in a careless way. Don't be like Scott, who put together a navigation to the South Pole in a haphazard, careless way with little thought. Approach it with prayer and reverence. With the heart and attitude that if this book speaks to me, I will obey.
I believe it was in that one session here in April we were talking. Y'all can listen in too, talking here in April. Remember that session where one guy, he didn't know how to study the Bible, and so he just kind of took it. He took the Bible and he opened it up at random and pointed his finger and said, you know what, he's trying to find God's word, God's will for his life. You know, he found the verse where it said, Judas hung himself. He didn't get real thrilled about that word from the Lord, so he closed it. So maybe we missed that time, God. So he opened it up again, trying to find out direction from God, what God wanted to do. And just said, man, put down and said, go, do thou likewise. You don't want to approach God's word that way. Approach it for what it is, the word of God, but open it for it. God's not a God of chaos. This book is put together in a meticulous, careful way so you and I can understand what it said. And so if you're not understanding what it said, learn how to understand that. It's a topic for another day. Okay? I'm not going to go into that today. But don't approach it just like some novel that you can pick up at haphazard. I mean, I'll tell you what, though. I got to tell you, when you open up a book, you normally start where? Normally at the beginning, I like to see who the author is, table of contents, that's a good place to start. And then from there, you have 66 books from which to choose. Simple suggestion, if you haven't started the journey of navigation to the Word of God, I'd go to the book of John and start this so you get to know Jesus Christ. It's like a picture album. And then I'd go right to the book of Acts, find out how to become a Christian. And then I'd read the rest of the books after that, how to live the Christian life. And once I got those things pretty well down, then I'd start journeying in some of the Old Testament. Revelation would be somewhere down the road. So, we approach it. We open it. What do we do next? After you open it, you begin to read it. And here's, I'm calling it, where we not just read it, but we actually hear it. We actually hear it. How many of you have trouble really listening to people over an extended period of time? Somebody said, what do you say? I did an experiment one time when I was in high school. I would not suggest you do this to your mother. And I've given up telling these jokes a long time ago. So I'm not even telling the joke, but it was a Pollock joke. It was a Pollock joke. And the Pollock joke was something like, did you hear about the Pollock that always said no? And my mom said, I was telling my mom this morning. She goes, no. And so I said, did you hear about the Pollock that always said no? And she went, no. And I said, you didn't hear about the Pollock that always said no? She never got it. She never got it. I said, forget that, Brian. I'm going to get to her again. I don't know if she was willing to listen to what I actually said. So when you're reading God's word, read it for what it is. You see, when you approach it for what it is, the Word of God. When you open it for what it is, the Word of God. When you read it, hear it for what it is, the Word of God. So if you're asking, what is God's will for my life? He has revealed it already. And I'm praying that this year will be the year of the Spirit, where we walk according to the Word of God, because to walk according to what the Word of God says is the same thing as walking to what the Spirit would want us to do, which is the same thing as walking the way Jesus walked. And how many of you know it's not enough just to hear it? Then we have to what? We have to apply it. We have to put it to practice. And so apply it for what it is. Apply it because you know it is the Word of God. We may not always understand why. God has asked us or even commanded us to do some things. I don't understand why He commanded us to be baptized in water. Why can't believe in Jesus and turn away from sin be enough? I don't know. Well, I was making up a plan of salvation. That wouldn't have been my plan. No, then again, if I was going to South Pole, I know I don't want to be with Scott. I'd rather be with Munson. And there's people today, even after the plan has already been written and recorded and says it will not change, there's still people today making up their own plans saying this one's not good enough. So we open it for what it is. We approach it, open it, hear it, and then we put it into practice. Even though we don't understand, and we realize that the rest of the world isn't following it necessarily either. But like Joshua said,
a couple weeks ago we talked about it, you remember? As for me and my house, we will what? We'll serve the Lord. But a preacher Dean does it not, we're going to serve the Lord. I pick on preacher Dean first because I have a problem with preachers. Not a commercial, I'm serious. Of the people in the religious world, I trust the least, I have to say, it's preachers. Because there's some preachers out there that have given bad names for preachers. And I don't trust them. Because their walk doesn't match their talk. And when someone comes in that might be of a religious persuasion different from them, they'll change their message to please the crowd. And I don't want to do that. I don't intend to do that. Why? Because I want us to go where? I want us to make it happen. Sometimes it's tough. Get the idea, I don't care about it. I love it. Navigating safely home. Do you understand? When we breathe our last, I mentioned a few weeks ago. It was Christmas Eve. Seems like a few weeks ago. I mentioned Christmas Eve. Joe was here Christmas Eve, just for you. Not here this morning. She was here. I said, Joe. And Joe is nearing the end, pancreatic stage 4 cancer. And I think I made the remark, we could go before her. So we could have a heart attack. And it was later that night, I read a post that a good preacher friend of ours, and you may know him, he used to work at Elkhorn Valley Christian Service Camp during weeks of camp. His name was John Martin. John Martin. From up north. John Martin had a massive heart attack and died on Christmas Day. He went before Joe. When I die, I anticipate seeing John Martin. If Joe goes before us and we go to heaven, I anticipate that we will see Joe and others of our loved ones. We're going to be reunited with those we served alongside for the consecration. By the way, not with that. We're going to meet for the first time, and I want to clarify, we're going to meet for the first time in person, Abraham. But if you've read the Bible, you've already met him. We're going to meet in person, Isaac. And we're going to meet in person, you name them. Anybody from the Bible you'd like to meet? Enoch. Yeah, that'd be cool. Hey, what's it like? How did he die? He's still out there. God just took him. His walk was so close with God. That's really what we're talking about, navigation. Good one. See, we haven't met them in person yet, but we have met them by navigating the Word of God. I'm going to run into them. We're going to see Jesus. So this past week, Christmas Day it was, we celebrated our first granddaughters, or our second best. Is she first or second? I think she's our first. Maybe you covered this. Well, I just didn't want to say, don't tell Sasha I was asking that. There she is, my daughter Sasha, with the Batman shirt. I'd get Karis and her kind of like turn because they were real close, weren't they? Anyway, 2 months, well, that was close. Compared to 57 years, 2 months is close. But anyway, having this conversation with Ken. Well, it was Macy's birthday, celebrating it on the 25th, even though her birthday was on the 24th. And Cam and I were sitting there eating ice cream cake. And I said, Cammy, how old are you? Because Macy's 10, right? I said, Cammy, and I really did. I really thought Cammy was older than what she is. I said, Cammy, how are you 8? She goes, Papa, I'm only 6. And on her own, I kid you not, she then said, I'm glad I'm not old, have to die anytime soon. And she looked really sad. I thought, where is this going? And I said, are you talking about Grandma Jo? She goes, yeah. She goes, Grandma Jo is my best friend. She said, literally, she said, I don't want Grandma Jo to die. She's my best friend. I said, so I'm trying to make her feel better. I'm trying to build her up on the faith, on the truth, not some mythological figure out there that kids grow up later to find out. I'm trying to teach you, this is the truth, these are the facts. I said, we're going to see Joe again. I said, Cammy, I said, I'm going to die someday. You're going to die someday. I said, but I'm going to die too. I'm going to see Joe. I'm going to see her again. And then she looked even sadder. She goes,
But for me, it's going to be so much longer. And I think you know the rest of the story. It goes a lot faster than you think. I'm just trying to bring some peace to that little girl. Again, this morning to you. Navigation. God wants us to navigate very carefully so that in the end of our life, we'll find what we really always wanted, just didn't know we needed. It's peace. Peace. And the reason we'll have peace is because Jesus said, it's my peace that I'm giving you. Not as the world gives me peace. The peace that the world gives, it doesn't last. But the peace I give, it'll last forever. And we'll have peace because we'll be with God, because we were at peace with God. And not only that, we're going to be with those who love God. Amen. Imagine that day if you would, which the scripture says, that we'll all bow down and cast our crowns at his feet. Are you ready this morning for that? Do you have yet to receive his spirit, that counselor of whom we spoke? John 16, verse 13. Do you have the one living within you that is given upon your immersion into Jesus Christ? Do you have him in your life to guide and counsel you so that in the very end you can say, as the psalmist said, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I what? Fear no evil. And as the pointed out, so I declare that. Because the very first words of that psalm, the blank is my shepherd. See, whoever you put there, that's the term of love and not yet peace. The blank is my shepherd. Who? The Lord is my shepherd. God bless you. As we stand, as we sing. We invite you to come today. As we prepare for the final day, and as we will all bow down before him. Let's be ready for that day.
We bow down, we lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus. The greatness of your mercy and love at the feet of Jesus. And we cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy, holy. Is the Lord. We fall down, we lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus. The greatness of his mercy and love at the feet of Jesus. And we cry, holy, holy, holy. And we cry, holy, holy. And we cry, holy, 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 is the Lamb. And we cry, holy, 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 and we cry, holy, holy, holy. And we cry, holy, 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 is the Lamb.
Is that the way you picture yourself when you approach the Word of God like this person here on his knees with Bible open, ears ready to hear? It's just me, or that song get louder toward the end? Something in the last night, I had it up loud enough so I could hear it at the beginning, and we got to that part. And so when you do go to the book of Revelation, folks, talking about navigation, you get anything in the book of Revelation, you start out with four elders, and then there's 12, and then there's 24, and then there's
thousands upon thousands, and then there's a number that you can't even count, and they're all praises in the land. It's like a crescendo of praise. It keeps getting louder and louder. And then you go down here with a granddaughter, and we end with her, and reach her Sasha. Lily's probably the youngest amongst us today. So I told you, Christmas Eve, she's saying, Dad, now. Father, thank you for the, your Bible calls the Abba relationship with you. It's like a child calling the daddy, dad, and papa. Thank you, Father, that we can approach you. We need not fear you as long as we're honoring you. So may you be our shepherd. We'll walk with you through the good and the bad. We'll see you face to face. We'll be pure in heart, Lord. We approach your Son, the Word, walk by the Spirit. So with a pure heart, we be fulfilled in us that we might see God. Magnify the Jesus said that in Jesus' name.
One day you're not to you, says.
Hey, hold on. You need some help tearing down the chairs again.